Sri Chaitanya Manobhistam Staptitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadam Mayam Dadati Swapadatikam Nama Om Vishnu Padai Krishna Prastai Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gaudvari Pacharini Never say so soon, you are a pastyatya de satarine. Vancha kalpatu vischa kripa sindhu ve vacha patita ram pavane bio vaishna ve bio namaho namaha. Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sri Vasa Igor Bhakta Vrindam. Hare Krishna 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 Hari Hari. Hari Ram 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 Hari Hari. Mar asrayam kata mrishta srinvati srinvanti kata yati cha tapanti vidvidas tapa naitamad gata cheta saham. Engaged constantly in chanting and hearing about me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the sadhus do not suffer from material miseries because they are always filled with thoughts of my pastimes and activities. Purport. There are multifarious miseries in material existence. Those pertaining to the body and mind, those imposed by other living entities, and those imposed by natural disturbances. But a sadhu is not disturbed by such miserable conditions because his mind is always filled with Krishna consciousness, and thus he does not like to talk about anything but the activities of the Lord. Maharaja did not speak of anything but the pastimes of the Lord by chamsing by Kunta Gunanavardhane. Engages word only in glorification of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Sadhus are always interested in hearing about the activities of the Lord or his devotees. Since they are filled with Krishna consciousness, they are forgetful of the material misery. Ordinary conditioned souls, being forgetful of the activities of the Lord, are always full of anxieties and material tribulations. On the other hand, since the devotees always engage in the topics of the Lord, they are forgetful of the miseries of material existence. This is a very fundamental and very clear explanation of the power of association with the Lord. It says that the Lord's name, his fame, form, qualities, pastimes, entourage are on the absolute platform. In other words, there's no difference between chanting Krishna's names and chanting the glories of Krishna and his pastimes, because they are pure, transcendental, and directly connected with the Lord. They are as good as the Lord. So here, it talks about material miseries. Adiyatmika, miseries of the body and mind. Adibhautika, miseries given by other living entities. And Adidaivika, imposed by natural disturbances. So here we have, these are the miseries that make up the material world. So if you're suffering from something, they fall into one of these three categories. Mm-hmm. You know, some people say we're suffering from this COVID. And so that's natural disturbances caused by the material energy. And then people who give us trouble, or tax collectors, mosquitoes, dogs, miseries by the other living entities, relatives, miseries pertaining to the body and mind. We all don't need any, but it says one is not disturbed by such miseries because they're filled with Krishna consciousness. So that's the power of Krishna consciousness. It can wipe away the effects of all miserable conditions. it takes you into a realm of existence that is beyond the miseries. Such as when you're reading or hearing Srimad-Bhagavatam, you're learning about the Lord, you're hearing about the glories of the Lord, and your mind is fixed on that. And then you forget. Time simply becomes conspicuous by its absence. We don't see the force of time. And that's true. Sometimes you see when people get absorbed in things they like, they forget about time. And they get absorbed in that. But unless it's spiritual, it's not free from these three forms of miseries here. So, satam prasangam mama virya sambido bhavanti hit karna rasayana kata najosita bhaktir ratir ukramin anukramishyati. That verse is coming up. It's the 25th verse in this chapter, so we'll get to that verse. But that verse illustrates this. Satam prasangam mama virya sambhido bhavanti rit karna. Rit means ear, karna means, rit means heart, karna means ear. The ear and the heart become charmed or filled with happiness when one finds themselves absorbed in hearing the glories of the Lord. Also, chanting the glories of the Lord are just as effective, or maybe even, I might say, even more effective, in the sense that one can get more absorbed when they glories of the Lord. Katyantas chimam nityam tushyanti cha ramanti cha tesam evanukam. No, that's not the word. The thoughts of my devotees dwell in me. Their lives are surrendered unto me. And they derive great satisfaction and bliss, enlightening one another and conversing about me. That's from the Bhagavad Gita. Machitat makata pranam bodhyantas patakarasparam katyantas chimam nityantushyanti cha. Tushyanti ramanti. Satisfaction and happiness comes with tush. Tush means satisfaction. Just like when you eat a nice meal, you become satisfied. It's called tushyanti, tushti. And then you have ramanti, or rama. Rama means pleasure. One experiences pleasure, real pleasure, internal pleasure, happiness that is within the heart and within the mind, not based on something external. So this is the essence of Krishna consciousness. Sometimes people want to know, where is the essence of our process? It's right here. It's easy. All you have to do is take this verse seriously and do it. And all your material miseries, anxieties, problems, everything is gone. But the tendency is, we don't give it enough time. We usually fill our day with so many other things, which are causes of, you know, perplexity and difficulties in our life. And therefore, we miss out on the nectar that is available by hearing and chanting the glories of the Lord. We often say that sometimes when a person becomes ill, they're forced to stop their regular activities. And what they do, they have to deal with their physical illness, but they find more time to hear and chant the glories of the Lord in that state. And many times they find more happiness in that state than they do when they're in a healthy condition. Persons who are afflicted with terminal diseases find themselves becoming absorbed in hearing and chanting the glories of the Lord. But it's not that we have to wait for a situation to arise in order to be forced into this. One should make it a regular part of the day to regularly hear and chant the glories of the Lord. Srila Prabhupada has given us so much nectar in his books, not only nectar, but relevant information that is very significant in our day-to-day life as we live in this material world. Srimad-Bhagavatam contains all activities, political, social, familial, transcendental. They're all transcendental, of course. And even basic practical things that we can learn in our life to improve the quality of our existence. But it's a matter of making time. We find many times there is always reasons why reading or hearing becomes optional at best, or not at all sometimes. We have our family responsibilities, we have our work responsibilities, we have our responsibilities with maintaining our own body, and we spend a lot of time during the day, you know, taking care of these things. But if we don't give in sufficient time to hear and chant the glories of the Lord, then we miss out. As Srila Prabhupada says, we miss the opportunity for transcendental happiness. Personally speaking, every morning prior to my breakfast, I read Srimad-Bhagavatam for at least an hour. And also, I take notes on the Bhagavatam while I'm reading and compile those notes into a file. So it helps me not only to read, but I can, when I note certain important statements within each of the verses, or sometimes we get ideas from the verse that sort of reflect the meaning of the verse, we also find that very helpful in our practice of Krishna consciousness. So Prabhupada's books, especially Srimad-Bhagavatam and Chaitanya Charitamrita, is filled with unlimited amounts of nectar. Because we don't have a taste for these things, we don't do it. Or if we do it, we do it very little. But taste will arise by continually practicing that process of hearing more and more in these great literatures. They cannot be compared to anything in this world. These literatures are like emperors compared to a little tiny village of the puny knowledge that we have in this material world, which is usually wrong anyway. Now, the knowledge we get in the practical level is always relative to a person, to the person who's saying it, and to the situation applying it to, where transcendental knowledge is applicable in all situations for all people and all lives. So this is the wealth of treasure. This knowledge, it's a great gift to have. Srila Prabhupada spent the time that everyone else was sleeping, he was awake throughout the night, giving his Bhaktivedanta purports, and sacrificing even his own health to try to finish Srimad Bhagavatam before he departed. Fortunately, he gave us up to 13 chapters of the 10th canto. And by the grace of his followers, they finished the 10th canto. But we can imagine if Srila Prabhupada was able to stay longer, how much more he would have gave us in the form of these Bhakti Vedanta purports, Srila Prabhupada would read his own books. Sometimes he would also laugh when he would be reading Krishna's pastimes. And he's the one that had been writing it, and now he's laughing when he's reading it, because as he explained to us, he said, these are not my words. I'm simply putting them on paper. These are Krishna's words. So Prabhupada was the medium by delivering Krishna's words to us through these great scriptures. And so we're practically hearing directly from Krishna when we hear from Prabhupada, who's practically not indifferent. The Krishna is telling us about himself in the form of his own pastimes through his pure devotee, Srila Prabhupada. We can imagine just the quality of that particular vakya, that katha is just so powerful. It frees one from all anxiety, it absorbs one in the mood of devotion, and it gives transcendental satisfaction. And as it says here, it completely obliterates the effects of the threefold miseries. And of course, sometimes when we stop, the threefold miseries come back. But when Prabhupada says, the devotees who are always engaged in the topics of the Lord, they are forgetful of the miseries of material existence. So the basic point of information is that we just don't take enough time to hear and chant the glories of the Lord. And then we wonder why we have so many problems. Because we're trying to solve problems that cannot be solved simply by our endeavor in this material world. We try to fix one thing and something else becomes unfixed. Life, each day, there's always a new set of challenges in our existence where we have to deal with. But if we are equipped with transcendental knowledge, as Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, in the very last verse of the fourth chapter, this transcendental knowledge is like a sword. It cuts through illusion. Bring that verse up. I think it's the last verse in the Bhagavad Gita. Chapter 4, verse number, I think it's 42. Bhagavad Gita 4:42. Just go to the very last verse in the chapter. Yeah, tasmad agyana sambhutam ritstam jigyana sinatmaham Chitvanam samsayam yoga matishta tishta bharata. Therefore, the doubts which have arisen in your heart of ignorance should be slashed by the weapon of knowledge. Armed with yoga or bard, stand and fight. So knowledge, transcendental knowledge, cuts through ignorance and destroys illusion. And it gives you determination in Krishna consciousness. This is the high knowledge is a form of sacrifice. Go to the same chapter and go to verse number 33. Same chapter 33. O chastiser of the enemy, the sacrifice performed in knowledge is better than a sacrifice of material possessions. After All sacrifices of work culminate in transcendental knowledge. This verse is in a series of verses talking about yajna, or sacrifice. And it precedes the next verse, which is the most powerful, one of the most powerful verses in the Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna talks about approaching a bona fide spiritual master. So there are sacrifices of possessions, sacrifices of, various types of sacrifices. Possessions is one of them. Sacrifice of work, sacrifice of knowledge is the highest form of sacrifice. So transcendental knowledge destroys illusion. It is the yajna for this age in the sense that it brings one to God realization. So the Shastras delineate all the benefits that one can receive by hearing and chanting transcendental knowledge. Srinvata Swakata Krishna Purnya Shravana Kirtanaha Ridyanantosto Apadrani Vidyanoti Suhit Sukham. And one who is eager to hear transcendental knowledge, Krishna does something. He enters into the heart of that devotee and he cleanses material desires from the heart. When he sees that devotee is eager to hear and chant his glories. So becoming absorbed in hearing and chanting the Lord is like taking a fresh bath after being unclean for a long time. We might use that analogy. It's very refreshing. It's very uplifting. It is very purifying. Now, transcendental knowledge is there. So the scriptures are there to transport our consciousness from the material to the spiritual. They are like a boat that crosses us over the ocean of material existence, bringing us to the shore of transcendental happiness. That is the shore. We are arriving at the shore. And of course, as we go further inland, the transcendental happiness becomes greater. So there are many programs that devotees have created in order to inspire devotees to hear and chant the glories of the Lord, especially from Srila Prabhupada's books. So this is the happiness that we can find in Krishna consciousness. And this point will be further next two verses coming up in the series that we are doing. So it works. It's authorized. Absorb yourself in transcendental knowledge and transcend the material modes of material nature. And then when you repeat these words to others, what we used to do in New Vrindavan, when I was there in the early days of my Krishna consciousness, devotees would have some difficult time staying awake in class because devotees didn't get much rest at night, and they would work hard all day. So when it's come to sat down and hearing, many times devotees would actually, doze off. So one of the methods we use to help, overcome this problem was to create a scenario where each and every devotee would have to ask another devotee that particular day, what did they say in the Bhagavatam class? And this was, of course, very helpful in keeping devotees awake. Wasn't always 100%. But what it did was it stimulated Krishna Katha. It stimulated transcendental discussions on what we had heard in that class that day. And there's knowledge about Krishna, and there's knowledge given by Krishna himself. There is knowledge of the philosophy of bhakti, and there's knowledge directly that relates to the name, fame, form, qualities, and pastimes of Krishna. So knowledge takes different aspects within the transcendental realm, and each of it is sweet. But the most sweetest of all knowledge is hearing Krishna's pastimes, especially his pastimes in Sri Vrindavan Dham. That's why out of all of the cantos of the Srimad-Bhagavatam, the most voluminous of all of the cantos is the 10th canto. It has 90 chapters. It is three or four times bigger than most of the other cantos, filled with all transcendental knowledge of Krishna's leelas. And they're very sweet. Just like yesterday I was reading, Kamsa had to take, Kamsa approached Akrura, and he said to Akrura, Akrura was one of his subjects in the kingdom. Of course, Akrura was a great devotee of Krishna. Kamsa had been sending so many demons to Vrindavan to kill Krishna, but all of the demons were killed by Krishna. So Kamsa was thinking, he knew that Krishna was going to be the person who'd kill him. So he was trying to kill Krishna in so many ways. So then he made a plot to bring Krishna to Mathura. He was the king of Mathura at the time, Kamsa. And he sent Akrura to persuade Krishna to come. And then Kamsa had his plan for killing Krishna by, having him face to face with a gigantic elephant. And if that didn't work, then there were two very powerful wrestlers, Mastika and Shunura, that were going to fight with Krishna and Balaram in wrestling. And so he had his plans to kill Krishna. So he sent Akrura. Akrura was a great devotee. And he only followed that because he knew that by bringing Krishna to Mathura, Kamsa would be killed. So he carried out Kamsa's instructions. And when Akrura finally met Krishna in Vrindavan and then explained the program, Krishna immediately agreed and Balaram, and they left. Of course, what happened, the gopis became overwhelmed with unhappiness, and they were trying to stop Krishna from going in so many ways. They even tried to run in front of the chariot, but nothing worked. The cowherd men, along with Nanda Maharaj, also accompanied Krishna to Mathura. But the gopis had to stay back, along with Mother Yasoda. So that was, and many of the cowherd boys. Some came with Krishna, not all. So on their way, of course, it's a beautiful description of what Akrura experienced when he was with Krishna. But finally, when they arrived in Mathura in the evening time of the same day, Krishna immediately turned to Akrura and said, I'm sure you're tired, so please go home, take rest, and we'll meet you again tomorrow. And that's the last thing Akrura wanted to hear. He was so attached to Krishna that the idea of being separated from Krishna, at least right now, after being with Krishna for about a week or more, it became horrible to think he would lose Krishna's association. So he made a nice plan or proposal to bring Krishna to his house. And so he started to glorify having the Lord at his house, how auspicious it would be for his family members, for his home. He would welcome him in so many different ways, wash his feet, offer nice food. He tried everything to get Krishna to come to his house. But Krishna, he had his plan in mind. He wanted to get right to the business. So before he wanted to meet with the opponents that Kamsa set up, Krishna wanted a tour of the city just to see what Mathura was like. He had been there before, but he was born in Mathura. But now he wanted to see the city, so he wanted him and Balaram, they decided to go on a little tour. So he told Akura, he said, Akura, I will meet you after I kill Kamsa, but right now I'm on my little tour. So Akura failed in bringing Krishna to his home, but he tried everything he could, feeling so much love for the Lord that it was impossible for him to be separate from the Lord. So the Lord is going through the city. He's meeting different people. He meets first the ladies of the city. They hear about Krishna and they go crazy. They run up on the top of the buildings to look at Krishna. They forget that some of them were putting on makeup and they put on halfway. Some of them were taking care of their babies and they completely left all that. Some were taking cooking for their husbands, they left that. And whatever they were doing, they immediately in haste and enthusiasm to see Krishna, they dropped everything. Sometimes they weren't even properly dressed. They were just running to see Krishna. In order to get a good view of Krishna, they ran up on the rooftops. And so after they all gathered on the rooftop and they were seeing Krishna and feeling the happiness of getting his darshan, and then they start, then Krishna saw them and he smiled. He smiled his beautiful smile and it just completely charmed their hearts even more, giving them assurance that he was very happy. And then they started to shower beautiful flowers on Krishna and Balaram, and that's nicely described. And then Krishna moves on, and then he comes across he's walking and he sees this washerman and he's carrying some load of clothes. So he says, "Oh, my dear washerman, you know, I would like to get some of the best of the laundered clothes that you have for myself and Balaram." And now the washerman, he was a mimical. He was a servant of Kamsa. He became angry at the Lord and started to insult the Lord for asking for clothes. He said, "These clothes belong to the king. Don't you realize what you're saying? You could be put in prison, beaten, and killed for the statements you're making. So don't speak like this." And Krishna didn't tolerate him at all. He simply took out the tips of his fingers and he hit him on the neck and cut his head off. And his head fell down and he fell down along with all his clothes. And then he had a group of people who were with him who were also carrying clothes. They also ran in fright. And then Krishna picked up some of the nicer clothes and put them on, dressed himself very nicely, Balaram too. And there was enough for the cowherd boys too, so they got some clothes too. And some of the clothes were left scattered on the ground. And then they went on. Next, they meet a garland maker. And the garland maker, oh, he's so happy to see the Lord. He comes up and offers respects, offers nice scents, incense, and various fragrances to Krishna. And then starts putting cloth decorations on Krishna in different ways, in different colors. Krishna's happy. He's decorating Krishna so nice. At the same time, he's offering, he's glorifying the Lord. And then after glorifying the Lord, offering so many respects, he asks the Lord, "How can I serve you?" And the Lord says, "Please give me the best of all garlands." And so he comes across with his garland and he gives him a beautiful garland like that. And then He's so happy to worship the Lord, and the Lord gives him a special benediction. He said, you will go back home, back to Godhead, to the end of life, and in the meantime, and during this life, you will receive full strength of energy, senses, intelligence, mind, healthy body. You will live a very happy material life with all opulences. And at the end, you will go back home. You will go to Vaikuntha, he said. Krishna said Vaikuntha. And so, Krishna's he's touring the city, meeting different people, and getting a chance for them to serve him. That's why he came. Simply, he wanted to tour the city, but he doesn't need to tour the city. He just wanted to see the devotees who were there, and so they can give them a chance to serve him in nice ways. And there were many that served him. And then, of course, the story goes on. That's as far as I got today in the pastime. But I remember from previous reading that the washerman who insulted Krishna, became angry at Krishna, appeared in Ram Lila as the person who criticized Lord Ram for accepting Sita back after Sita had been captured by Ravana. So he had a committed offense to Lord Ram at the time. So that same person, reborn as a washerman in Mathura, seeing the Lord again in his form as the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna, he had an opportunity to purify himself from all his bad qualities and his previous bad karma. But he ruined his whole thing. Rather than acknowledging the Lord's request, the Lord very nicely asked him from some of the best clothes, giving him a chance to serve. But he lost the opportunity, and Krishna, when he insulted the Lord thought the best thing for him is to get a new body. So he relieved him of his bad mentality. So all these pastimes are there in Srimad-Bhagavatam, and so they're so beautifully arranged with such literary embellishments that describe in a very poetic form the pastimes as they are being described in the Bhagavatam. And then, of course, the commentaries and the purports, and a lot of the commentaries are reflective of the acharyas, such as Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Jiva Goswami, and others, who comment on these pastimes and give us deeper insight of what is actually happening. So Krishna's leelas are so sweet, so deep, so profound, and so full of happiness. We take time to hear these pastimes, read these pastimes, and then, as this verse says, you can be freed from the miseries of material nature. Okay, so let's stop there.
Thank you so much, Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much for a nice class and nice pastimes. Thank you so much. Devotees, if you have any questions or comments or realizations, please go ahead.
And if you can make your comments, the pastimes that you're reading also, you can enlighten us with some of your experiences.
Devotees, any questions? comments, as Guru Maharaj said.
Okay, I don't hear anything, so.
Guru Maharaj, Mohanasni Radha Mataji is asking, thank you so much, dear Guru Maharaj. It was very inspiring to me. I'm wondering about how to get more inspiration in hearing such pastimes.
Just do it. Don't wait for, don't wait for the roof to collapse before you fix it. Just do it. The inspiration comes when you do it. The acharyas are saying do it. The Bhagavatam is saying do it. Krishna is saying do it. The devotees are saying just do it. What more do you need? Just do it.
Namita Mataji, you want to go ahead?
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. My humble obeisances to you, Maharaj. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, Maharaj. So, Maharaj, I had a similar question. I always struggle to read. I don't really find that time. And again, reading is not my strong point. But everyone says that you've got to chant, you've got to hear, and you've got to read as well. So I just wanted to ask the same thing, that how do I do that? In sense, how do I get inspiration to read? And if I'm not reading, is that still okay or no? I have to read. Like, I try that I read a verse every single day before I go to bed, but it doesn't happen all the time.
There's no taste. You have to develop the taste. Taste comes by doing it. If you can't get a taste directly, you can say you can do it as a service. It's my duty to read. Nasta prayeshu abhidrasya nityam bhagavata sevaya bhagavati uttama sloki bhakti bhagavati naishtaki. The benefits are there. Some individuals, perhaps you are in that category, are not inclined to reading. You can always hear this knowledge in an audio form. But when you have the book in your hand, I mean, I gave a long, long seminar a couple times on why it's important more than ever now to read Srila Prabhupada's books. Maybe some of you remember that seminar. It was a PowerPoint presentation that we gave. And then back in September of last year, there was the reading marathon that was going on all over the ISKCON movement. So pick a section in Prabhupada's books that may attract you and then read that. It's not that you have to systematically read. Of course, systematically read is also recommended, but the idea is to somehow or other break through. And helping to break through means find something that will be attractive for you to read. Like today, right after lunch, I sat down for a little while and I did a few things and I thought, well, I'm gonna read some more. So I was reading and Jiva Goswami's Bhagavad Sandarbha, and I was reading a little bit about Bhakti Tirtha Swami's reflections. And so just by doing that, it fixes the mind, it awakens some kind of... So you can start reading groups. You can get a group of two or three people to read together, and then someone reads, and then you discuss amongst yourself. You don't want to get more than three or four people in a group like that. That will help. But we always indicate that in order to make sure you read, you have to put it in as part of your regular schedule. I found myself a while back, maybe a couple months back, my schedule got a little bit adjusted due to circumstance, and I lost that normal reading time, and I was trying to fill it in at other times during the day, and I found that I wasn't able to do it regularly. I would miss a day here and there. So only when I got back to my regulated time, then I was able to continue with the reading. So, I mean, if you like, we can, in the future, I can give a seminar on the importance of reading Prabhupada's books, which is an interactive seminar. It will include discussion between myself and all the devotees who are hearing, but it helps to dispense with the reasons why we don't read and gives us the reasons why we should read. Aside from the fact that it's nice.
It is, Maharaj. I find it very enlightening. And as you said, I have actually made a good start over the lockdown, and I've read, lots of Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Krishna book, with lots of friends. But yeah, it's just that discipline. And I'd love to actually attend that presentation that you said that you have whenever, if you run it, I would love to attend that session. Or I don't know if you have a recording somewhere or any devotee has it. Even then, I would love to actually just go through it myself.
Well, there's two things. There's one PowerPoint seminar that's been recorded, and then there's the interactive class, which is just a discussion on principles of reading and not reading. So the seminar is recorded. I think both are recorded. You just have to go to my website and speak with Nanda Sunu. He's right there in London, so it's not far, just a phone call away. Talk to Nanda Sunu, and Nanda Sunu. He can give you the, everybody knows Nanda Sunu. All you have to do is have some connection with people in the manor. Everybody knows Nanda Sunu.
Yes, Maharaj, I'll connect with him, definitely.
Yeah, and you can find that there's many, I think there's many presentations. I've talked about this subject innumerable times. There's also YouTube lectures on, so many things.
Yes, Maharaj. Thank you, Maharaj. I'm going to definitely connect with the Nanda Sunu Prabhu.
Once you get the taste, then you'll understand everything I'm saying. It's getting that taste that needs to be done, because until you get that taste, you can't understand how wonderful it is to hear and chant the glories of the Lord.
Absolutely, Maharaj.
It's a sweet taste. It comes.
Absolutely, Maharaj. I'll just pray to Krishna that, I get that taste, because I love hearing, and obviously I like, I love chanting as well, but reading is one of my weaknesses. So I'm going to work on it.
There's two ways to read. You can read silently or you can read out loud. So sometimes reading out loud is very, very more, very much helpful.
I think reading out loud would be very effective for me.
Yeah, that seems to be, for those who are a little sleepy or less attentive when they read, that reading out loud overshadows that these things.
Thank you, Maharaj. Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj.
Guru Maharaj, Mohanasni Radha Mataji is writing, actually, I'm looking for philosophy where I can reflect and get realizations. That's where I find inspiration at the moment, in self-growth. I would like to know if that is proper. I mean, for example, false ego. I try to work on that for last few months, and there is still a lot to do.
You want to know where you can find information on the false ego?
Yeah, actually she is telling that she is focusing right now on self-growth, and she is more interested in looking for philosophy where she can get reflections and realizations.
So, yeah, Bhakti Tirtha books, the beggars, beggar 1, 2, 3, and 4 is really good for opening up these reflective type of, and then we have Devaki. She wrote a book called The False Ego, the enemy of the mind, the false ego. I haven't read the book, but it's quite, it's, I know that when she puts something together, it's quite interesting and thorough. You can get Devaki's book on the false ego. Bhakti Tirtha Swami has done a lot of reflective writing. Most of his writing is reflective.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj.
I'm surprised Mohanasini, she's a reader. She's actually a scholar. She knows so much.
Yeah, she's telling that she's that book she's reading now from Devaki Mataji.
Okay. I'm surprised she asked that question because she reads. She knows the philosophy.
So actually her question is, Maharaj, like she's asking, is it a good inspiration? Like self-growth is a good inspiration? Like
that's the best inspiration. Mm. Growing the self into Krishna, cutting away from those mayas. The mind will always give you trouble. Just keep that mind connected to transcendental knowledge. Okay, so does Sri Devi have her daily question today? No?
Sri Devi Mataji, do you have any question?
Please accept my humble obeisances, Guru Maharaj. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to you, Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much for emphasizing how important it is to read Prabhupada's books. Just yesterday, I had my usual monthly meeting with my mentor, and I was saying the exact same thing like Mohanasini Radha. Somehow I'm not able to really get into, and Namita also said that, you know, hearing, chanting, but reading is such an important habit. And she just said the same thing you said, Guru Maharaj. She said, just do it. These are her exact words. She said, just do it, Sri Devi. Just sit down, sit with a notebook and just read. And as you read, you will get the taste. Take notes. She said, keep a notebook and write down, because that will help you to again go back and read. And whenever something strikes you, you can again go back to that verse and it will bring so much solace. Say you've been anxious about something. She said, Srimad-Bhagavatam is your best friend. She said, Srimad-Bhagavatam is your best friend. There's no better friend than Srimad-Bhagavatam. So make it a point to read. So I just wanted to share that, Guru Maharaj, what Mother Vishwadika said. Thank you.
Yeah, right on. You have spoken words of complete truism. Absolute truth. Okay.
Any more questions? Yes,
Guru. Yeah, Lavanya, I'll give you that reference right now.
Yes, Guru Maharaj.
For tomorrow. Let me escape here for a minute and see where I have to go. Okay. Are you still there?
Yes, Guru Maharaj.
Okay, let me see here. We get, just give me a minute here. Okay, let's see. We have, Okay, so Sunday, June 27th at, it's at 3 p.m. UK time. It's not 4. I'm sorry, I said 4. It's 4 o'clock my time, 3 p.m. UK time. And I'll forward this email to you.
Yes, good morning.
And you'll have all the information.
Sure.
Let's see. Okay.